good morning to all of you all. It's heartening to see the punctuality between all of you all and to come sharp on time. And we are going to have an exciting session for GI disorder. We are going to take you right from spectrum of intestinal problems, liver problems, hematological problems, and wind it up with grand rounds. The main scenario is to give you a very practical approach to GI disorder. We had a seminar on 7th of March. This was at Nehru Science Center. I believe all of you all were aware about it. It was a pediatric liver CME where we had faculty from all over India coming to this. It was more of a super specialty CME. And we had around 250 doctors from all over India attending that seminar. So we realized that the same thing needs to be addressed to the general practitioner in a more practical point of view. So that, because you are the ones who are seeing these patients firsthand, and we need to have a correct approach to these patients so that they get best of the care possible, and that's what we are going to do, is share our experience with you. Now the first, you all have the program with you. The first thing that we are going to cover is approach to hepatosplenomegaly, followed by a talk by Dr. Vivek Rege. And then we are going to have grand rounds, which will be related to this lecture. And then we are going to follow up with diarrhea. Now, the thing is here that we are going to do is approach to hepatosplenomegaly. What I've realized is over a period of time when we've been teaching, especially when I've been teaching undergraduates and postgraduates, I find that this topic is really difficult to teach them. Because whenever they do a case presentation to me, hepatosplenomegaly, it always lands up being fumbling. And you don't know what you're doing. Is it anemia? Is it jaundice? Is it just hepatosplenomegaly? So we just don't know what's happening here. So when I was sitting and making these slides, I tried to analyze as to how we could approach. And this is a very unique approach that has come to me. And I hope you enjoyed as much as I did enjoy preparing these slides. So we start off without much time and we go to hepatosplenomegaly. Now, why would a liver and a spleen enlarge? That is the first question that comes to our mind, is why would they enlarge? That means there's something wrong in the liver and the spleen. That's why they are enlarging. Why are they enlarging? Because there's something wrong. They need to function better. As they need to function better, they need to increase their capacity. And because they need to increase their capacity, they enlarge. So if there is something wrong in the function, the organ enlarges. So what would be the functions of a spleen? If we could understand what the functions of a spleen were, we would understand which function is not functioning, the spleen will enlarge. So the functions of the spleen, one is it's a reticular endothelial system. So it's got reticular endothelial cells. So anything that is going to affect this system is going to cause enlargement of the spleen. So any infection of the reticular endothelial system, any inflammation of the reticular endothelial system is going to cause a problem. Second, it's an organ of extramedullary hematopoiesis. So this function has to come into the picture. When will it come into the picture? It's normally not functioning like this. But when will this function come into the picture? When the regular hematopoiesis is not taking place. So where is the regular hematopoiesis taking place? In the bone marrow. Now, if the bone marrow is not functioning, the spleen has to take up the function of producing the hematopoietic cells. And that's the reason why we get it as an organ of extramedullary hematopoiesis. So any bone marrow disorder may cause this to occur. Then spleen has got a function of destroying old cells. So any degenerative cells are destroyed. So the RBCs will be destroyed, any infected cells. So if the RBCs are getting deformed much earlier or they are getting degenerated much earlier, the spleen will start destroying them. And if the spleen has to function at a higher capacity of destruction, it will enlarge. So that is another function. Now what will it do? It also destroys infected cells, so infected WBCs. So any infection, and the macrophages have something in them, the spleen is the bodyguard of the body. So it notices, oh, this is wrong in the body, this cell is functioning wrong, this cell is functioning wrong. It has to destroy those cells. So whichever cells, so infected cells, it will have to destroy. So again, that's where the spleen will enlarge. And spleen has got a wonderful circulation. It's connected to the liver with a portal circulation. Now any problem in the portal circulation means spleen has to enlarge. So these are the functions of the spleen. Any abnormality in this function means spleen will enlarge. Similarly, if we go to the liver, what are the functions of the liver? The main function of the liver is detoxification. Whereas renal kidney is important to remove all the waste product from the body, similarly liver is important to remove all the waste product which comes through the liver. So how does it detoxify? It detoxifies your ammonia, it detoxifies bilirubin. So if it cannot detoxify, if there is anything wrong, bilirubin rises. So then liver has to compensate. If bilirubin is rising, liver has to compensate, it has to enlarge. Similarly, if there are any other waste products, then it has to enlarge. Liver is a wonderful organ. Just as we have one heart, we have one liver. Everything else is double in our body, except for one heart and one liver. So liver is very, very essential. It's a center for detoxification. It's a center for manufacturing. So what does it manufacture? It manufactures various proteins and it manufactures various clotting factors. So if there is increased requirement of proteins or if there is increased requirement of clotting factors, the liver will enlarge. Or if the liver, part of the liver is not able to function that way, then the other part should enlarge. So that is the reason you will get enlargement. It's also a center which stores glucose. If you have extra glucose in the body, that glucose is going to get stored as glycogen in the liver. Now whenever we require this glycogen, the liver again causes gluconeogenesis. Gluco means glucose, neo means new, and genesis means formation. So new glucose formation takes place through the liver because it's the storehouse of glycogen. So this, if glycogen keeps on storing in the liver and gluconeogenesis does not occur, liver will enlarge. So that's one of your features of storage disorder. When you talk about glycogen storage disorder, glycogen is storing, but it's not getting formed into glucose. So you get a liver enlargement. It's also storage of various vitamins. Your B12 is stored in the liver. Your other fat-soluble vitamins are stored in the liver. It helps in absorption of fat-soluble vitamins. Water-soluble vitamins don't need anything to get absorbed. Fat-soluble vitamins, that is your A, D, E and K, require bile to get absorbed into the system. So liver is very important for fat-soluble and it also stores these. Excretion functions from whatever detoxification has occurred, it has to get excreted out. In kidney, whatever it has occurred, got excreted out in the urine. Similarly here, whatever detoxification occurred, gets excreted out in the body. So it's an organ of excretion function. Now if that does not occur, if there's a block somewhere, there's a gallstone somewhere, or there's a choledochysis somewhere, the excretion does not occur. Liver gets accumulated with all these toxic things, gets bilirubin, it will enlarge. So again, that is the cause. It's also a system of reticular endothelial system, just like the skin. So again, infection, inflammation will cause the liver to enlarge. And it's an organ of extramedullary hematopoiesis. This comes into the picture when bone marrow is not functioning, just like the skin. So any problems in this will cause the liver to enlarge. So why does splenomegaly occur? If there is reticular system involvement. So involvement of reticular endothelial system is infection or inflammation. Activation of extramedullary hematopoiesis. Bone marrow is not enough, liver has to take up. So your hemolytic anemia, thalassemia, what will happen is the spleen will enlarge. Then it has to destroy the RBCs. Now there are RBCs that are deformed, like the G6PDs or fibrate kinase deficiencies. Spleen will enlarge. Or it has to destroy infected RBCs, malaria. So if it has to destroy infected RBCs, the spleen has to enlarge. And it will cause the destruction. Destruction of macrophages with infected RBCs. So what will it do with macrophages if there are any infections in the body which are macrophage related? It will enlarge. Any problem with the portal circulation, so portal hypertension, spleen will enlarge. And storage. Obviously anything that is stored in the kidney or the liver or the spleen will enlarge. So reticular endothelial system, infection, inflammation. Which are the common infections that affect this? Malaria, brucella, kalaazar, infections, mononucleosis. We are all seeing typhus nowadays, rickettsia we are seeing very commonly. Infective endocarditis, HIV, TB. These are the common infections that affect the spleen. Now, we have been taught this right from our undergraduate days. Mild splenomegaly, malaria, infective endocarditis, large pleomegaly, kala azar, leukemia. That's how we've been taught. But it makes no sense remembering it that way, because once upon a time the spleen was small to begin with and it increased over a period of time. So what we should remember is, what are the problems that can cause this pleomegaly? So infection, and as I said, inflammation. What do I mean by inflammation? Autoimmune problems. Rheumatoid arthritis, SLE. These are the ones that can cause a splenomegaly. Activation of extramedullary hematopoiesis, hemolytic anemia such as thalassemia, hereditary spherocytosis, so anything where the bone marrow is not producing proper hemoglobin or proper RBCs, so hereditary spherocytosis. Leukemia, why in leukemia should the spleen enlarge? Because in the bone marrow, the entire marrow is filled up with these blast cells or leukemic cells. So there is no space for normal cells to come out. So the bone marrow is completely full, so the normal cells have to come from the other areas. So leukemia is enlarged. And iron deficiency anemia, very surprisingly, long-standing iron deficiency anemia can cause extramedullary hematopoiesis. So if I have a child who is long-standing hemolytic anemia, iron deficiency anemia, it's not surprising to present as a hemolytic crisis with hepatitis pneumonia, but not acute iron deficiency. This has to be long-standing in 5 to 6 months or maybe even 1 year. That's when this will start taking place. Destruction of deformed RBCs, hemolytic anemias, autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Destroy infection-laden cells, malaria, leptospirosis, dengue. Now, leptospirosis, dengue, this is the reason why the spleen enlarges. Affection of portal circulation will be portal hypertension, either due to chronic liver disease or it will be extrahepatic portal hypertension. Little difference between the two. What happens here? Extrahepatic portal hypertension means the portal vein is blocked somewhere. So there is a clot somewhere, there is a thrombosity. That's extrahepatic. Liver is bi-normal. So when we see them, we actually see them with collaterals. Just like you get a coronary heart, where you get a block and then the collaterals form. Similarly, your portal circulation, if it gets blocked, you will get a block if you pick up in the acute phase. If you pick up just in the splenomegaly, you will see just collaterals. Liver is normal. The other reason may be the liver is abnormal. The portal veins are affected, and that's why you are getting portal hypertension. Okay, so you can get both the reasons causing portal hypertension. And obviously storage in the spleen. So what kind of storage? Gaucher's disease commonly, GM1, GM2, metastasis. The blast cells or leukemic cells have gone and infiltrated the spleen, they'll enlarge. So metastasis and histiocytosis. So these are the causes of storage kind of process. Now when would hepatomegaly occur? Hepatomegaly will occur if there is improper functioning of the liver. So problems in detoxification, problems in synthesis of fluid. Acute hepatitis, chronic hepatitis. So these are the problems of the liver. Gluconeogenesis is not taking place. Glycogen is not getting converted to glucose. So all glycogen is getting stored in the liver. Glycogen storage disorder. Storage problems. Again, it's not only glycogen, but you can get other substances that can store in the liver. Like you can get mucopolysaccharidosis, so GM1, GM2, all these can form a storage. So a very large liver in an otherwise normal child, think of a storage. Excretory function is obstructed, so gallstones, cholecystitis, these are the problems. Reticular system and extramedullary hematopoiesis. So improper functioning of the liver, as we said, it will be acute hepatitis, chronic. Acute means your hepatitis A, E, even B can come as acute. These are the common acute hepatitis. Acute hepatitis also means dengue, leptospirosis. It also means your typhoid. Chronic hepatitis. So acute hepatitis A, E, typhoid, malaria, dengue, leptospira. We should not forget CMV and infectious wound diseases. Enteroviruses can also cause hepatomegaly. Herpes virus, other, septicemia, DIC. These are all causes of acute hepatitis. There's chronic hepatitis. It could be viral, such as hepatitis B or C. It could be autoimmune hepatitis. It could be metabolic like Wilson's in children. Alcoholic liver disease we don't see in children. But in adults, you will have to keep that in mind. So when we are talking about chronic liver disease, three things. Viral, autoimmune, metabolic. Adult, alcoholic. Okay? So these are the things that we need to keep in mind. Storage. Glycogen storage is the commonest. Others are GM1, GM2, Niemann-Pick, Gauchers. Malignancy again, because metastasis can go. histiocytosis and liver abscess. Liver abscess is something that will again cause like a space occupying lesion and will cause space occupying and liver enlargement. Excretory function is obstructed. Younger children, bile duct is itself atrophy, so biliary atresia, polydocal cyst, gallstones. These are the common causes of excretory function being obstructed. And reticular system affection means infection or inflammation. Infection of the liver, HIV, disseminated TB, Brucella calor. When we talk about acute hepatitis, we cover the entire list elsewhere. This is only a reticular endothelial system. So asymptomatic hepatomegaly. Think of HIV, think of disseminated TB, Brucella calor, infectious mononucleosis and autoimmune. Extramedullary, same thing, hemolytic anemia and iron deficiency. So what happens when the spleen enlarges? Now, how do we identify each problem? We understood why the spleen is enlarging and we understood why the liver is enlarging. Now we need to know what happens when they enlarge. Those are the things that have come to us as symptoms. And these are the symptoms that will help us to identify the problem. When the spleen enlarges, its functions increase. So what will happen? It will start destroying RBCs. It will start destroying RBCs, it will start coming as anemia. So a child with splenomegaly may present you as anemia. Because the hemoglobin is being destroyed so much, the bilirubin will rise, the unconjugated bilirubin will rise, which the liver has to conjugate. So it will come as indirect jaundice. Then if the spleen really enlarges a lot and it causes hypersplenism, then all cell lines will go down. So WBCs will start going down, platelets will start going down. So you'll get thrombocytopenia, leukopenia. So they may come to you as petty case, bleeding manifestation. Or if the WBC count has fallen quite a lot, then they may come with infection, then they'll come to you as fever. With portal hypertension, always a chance that the rupture of the vessel may take place. They may come to you as varices and hematomas. So if you have spleen enlarged, look for anemia, indirect jaundice, thrombocytopenia, fever and hematomas. So these are the symptoms that they should come to you. What happens when the liver enlarges? Now when the liver enlarges, one is its function of detoxification does not take place. So it should cause jaundice, ammonia should rise if it's really bad liver, then encephalopathic liver. Proteins are not being synthesized, so it will come as hypoalbuminuria. Long standing, the liver cause ascites, edema. Because clotting factors are not being formed, it can cause bleeding manifestations. Glucose is not being formed, so they may have sudden hypoglycemia. So in fact, we always tell liver patients, please take sweets at least 4 hours, even at night, take something to eat and keep sugar with you. So in case you can bleed, at least take some sugar with you. Excretion is poor. So again, jaundice, because bilirubin has accumulated. Because bile is not going, fat soluble vitamins are not getting absorbed. Cholesterol is building up in the body. Pruritus, so a lot of itching. And fat-soluble vitamin deficiency. Then the color of the stool changes. If there is an obstruction, the normal color of the stool is because of the bile. If bile does not come into the stool, stool color changes. So it becomes white in color. If it's an infection, you get fever. And extramedullary hematopoiesis has started taking place.